Basirangi, as the name indicates, is a group of nuclei located at the base of the brain. So what are these nuclei? These are caudate nucleus, putamen, globus pallidus, substantia nigra pars reticulata, and subthalamic nucleus. So these five nuclei form the basal ganglia. Now among these, caudate nucleus and putamen together are known as striatum. Now this striatum acts as the receiving nuclei of basal ganglia, that is, striatum receives the afferents which are coming through the basal ganglia, while globus pallidus and substantia nigra pars reticulata are the output nuclei, that means they send the efferents from the basal ganglia, and subthalamic nuclei is connected to the globus pallidus. Now let us elaborate on that basic circuitry: thalamic trigger exciting the cortex and thalamus under negative control of basal ganglia. So instead of basal ganglia, now we will introduce the receiving and output nuclei of basal ganglia. So instead of basal ganglia, let us write here striatum and globus pallidum. Since globus pallidus is the output nuclei of the basal ganglia, so that means globus pallidus will send the inhibitory signal to the thalamus. So here it will be globus pallidus. Now this striatum receives signals either from cortex or from substantia nigra pars compacta, which causes release of dopamine. For simplicity's sake, we are writing here only as cortex, but actually this striatum receives input from vast areas of the cortex. So there are various loops connecting different regions of the cortex to basal ganglia and thalamus. So one of these loops is the motor loop, where motor cortex has connections with the striatum has connections with globus pallidus, thalamus, and again back to the cortex. Then there are other loops also, which is non-motor loops. This is where the basal ganglia has connections with the cingulate cortex. So this will be responsible for the limbic and emotional functions. So like the movement for the facial expressions, the expression of emotions. So these non-motor loops are the ones which control that limbic and emotional functions. Then there is another oculomotor loop also for control of the eye movement. However, we are splitting these into loops, but you see the main activity of basal ganglia in all the loops will be to modulate the thalamocortical activity. That is, either for the initiation of motor activity or for the suppression of motor activity. So when initiation of any motor activity is needed, we will want that this inhibitory control of the basal ganglia to the thalamus should be withdrawn so that thalamus is able to stimulate the cortex. For suppression of motor activity, we will need that this inhibitory control of the basal ganglia to the thalamus is retained or maybe even made stronger and thalamus is not able to excite the cortex. Now this is a schematic diagram of basal ganglia nuclei showing striatum, pallidum as two parts, globus pallidus externa and globus pallidus interna. We were telling that pallidus inhibits the thalamus. So here that internal part of the pallidus, that is the globus pallidus internus, actually keeps the thalamus inhibited. Then we know that excitatory signals from thalamus go to the cortex. Now we will introduce some other components also. So apart from GPI, there is another nucleus, that is the substantia nigra pars reticulata, which also keeps thalamus inhibited. Now in direct pathway, the striatal neurons have an inhibitory control over neurons of GPI. Because the striatum is directly inhibiting the output nuclei of basal ganglia, that is why this is known as the direct pathway. It also inhibits substantia nigra pars reticulata. But remember, these striatal neurons do not fire tonically. Only when they are activated, they will cause inhibition. Tonic firing occurs in GPI and SNPR. Okay, now let us see the indirect pathway. In indirect pathway, two more nuclei come into role. That is the GPE and subthalamic nucleus. So in indirect pathway, striatum inhibits GPE, which in turn inhibits GPI. So if you see what is happening, that striatum is actually exciting GPI. In direct pathway, what happened? That striatum was inhibiting GPI so that GPI won't be able to inhibit thalamus. That means the thalamus was becoming disinhibited. Here, GPE is actually inhibiting GPI. But if GPE is inhibited by striatum, it will not be able to inhibit GPI and GPI will continuously keep on inhibiting thalamus. Another nucleus which has a role in indirect pathway is subthalamic nucleus. Subthalamic nucleus has an excitatory connection with globus pallidus internus. So that means when subthalamic nucleus is active, globus pallidus will be able to inhibit thalamus more. But subthalamic nucleus is itself inhibited by globus pallidus externus. So basically, in indirect pathway, this GPE, globus pallidus externus, is inhibiting globus pallidus internus by two ways. First, by directly inhibiting globus pallidus internus, and secondly, preventing the excitation of GPI from subthalamic nucleus by inhibiting subthalamic nucleus. Let's summarize what we have understood till now. First of all, for movement to be initiated, thalamus should excite cortical neurons. For this, GPI should be inhibited since GPI is tonically inhibiting thalamus. Only when GPI is inhibited, thalamus will be disinhibited and it will be able to excite the cortex. Secondly, we saw that striatal neurons are not always active. But when they are active, they can act by two pathways, direct and indirect. Now the fundamentals. You see, the direct pathway, when it is active, it facilitates movement. And when indirect pathway is active, it inhibits movement. How? Indirect pathway, because striatum is inhibiting GPI, GPI will not be able to inhibit thalamus. Thus, thalamus can send excitatory signals to cortex. So, thalamus is triggering cortex for movement. So, direct pathway is facilitating movement. On the other hand, indirect pathway, if you solve all these connections, what will happen? That ultimately, it will cause GPI to be able to inhibit thalamus more. So that thalamus will not be able to excite cortex. So indirect pathways inhibiting movement. So how can the movement be initiated? Now this direct and indirect pathway which we saw exists for each and every movement. Say for example, if you want to flex your arm. So there is one direct pathway and one indirect pathway for your elbow flexion. So, direct pathway will facilitate elbow flexion and indirect pathway will inhibit elbow flexion. Similarly, for elbow extension, there is direct pathway and also an indirect pathway, where direct pathway facilitates elbow extension and indirect pathway inhibits elbow extension. So, if you want to flex your elbow, what happens? The direct pathway of elbow flexion is activated so that there is facilitation of elbow flexion and indirect pathway of elbow extension is activated so that there is inhibition of elbow extension. As we have said earlier, direct pathway facilitates movement, indirect pathway inhibits movement. So, for successful elbow flexion to occur, direct pathway of this movement is activated and indirect pathway of opposite movement is inhibited. But what about indirect pathway of elbow flexion? If that is also activated, then even if there is activation of the direct pathway, indirect pathway will tend to suppress that movement. So there will be hesitation or trouble in initiating the movement because indirect pathway is kind of putting a brake on that movement. So here comes the role of dopamine released from substantia nigra pars compacta. Neurons from substantia nigra pars compacta have connections with the striatum. These neurons release dopamine which act on striatal neurons in a differential manner. The released dopamine excites the direct pathway, but it inhibits the indirect pathway. So since direct pathway facilitates movement, its excitation facilitates the movement. And since indirect pathway inhibits movement, dopamine inhibits indirect pathway and thus facilitating the movement. So this dopamine is said to have a modulatory role for the movement. Because cortex itself is able to initiate the movement, however, indirect pathway will put a brake on it. But dopamine will facilitate the movement and there will be no hesitation in initiating the movement. Problems in this circuitry will create movement disorders. Either there will be disorders in initiation of motor activity or disorders in suppression of motor activity. If globus pallidus does not inhibit thalamus when required, it will lead to increased excitatory signal from thalamus to the cortex. This will happen because globus pallidus is not able to inhibit thalamus. So this increased trigger will lead to hyperkinetic disorders. On the other hand, if pallidum suppresses too much, that means this inhibitory signal becomes too strong, there will be decreased excitation of cortex from the thalamus. So this green signal will be lesser and it will lead to some hypokinetic disorders because cortex is less excited. So with basal ganglia disorders, there can be movement disorders of both types in which there is a problem in initiation of motor activity, which are known as the hypokinetic disorders, and there may be problems in suppression of motor activity, which are known as the hyperkinetic disorders.